Good morning, everyone. Today, it's our immense pleasure to have with us Dr. T. Jawahar Abraham. Sir is Professor, Department of Aquatic Animal Health, Faculty of Fishery Sciences, West Bengal University of Animal and Fishery Sciences, Kolkata. And sir, you are audible as well as visible. The presentation is also visible. Can you switch to the presentation, sir? So that, can you minimize and go to the PPT?
Okay. Is it visible?
Hello?
Is this visible now?
Yeah. Can you start the slideshow?
Okay. So your introduction is over?
Yeah. Can you maximize, can you start the slideshow?
That I will do. So your introduction is over?
Yeah. Just one message for the participants.
Okay.
One message for the participants. Once I start recording the session, you have to accept it. If somebody doesn't accept the recording permission, he will be removed from the room by default. So whenever the recording starts, you have to accept it. Thank you, sir. You can start, sir.
Okay. So good morning, Nasrit, and fellow participants. So very good morning to everyone. Okay. So nice to be here in this forum, online platform. So that has brought almost about 100 members to be here in this presentation. So as Nasrit said, okay, I am Dr. Abraham from the Faculty of Fishery Sciences of the West Bengal University of Animal and Fishery Sciences. Okay, so I am fortunate to be here today for the presentation on the developments in fish health management. So am I audible before going to the session? Participants?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Okay. So that's fine. Okay. So now, so this topic is on something related to the diseases.
Yes, sir. Morning.
Okay. Very good morning. So this this topic, the presentation today is something related to the diseases, and you call, okay, broadly the diseases any deviation from the normal structure or the function of any part of the body or any organ. So that is manifested by the characteristic set of symptoms and signs. So etiology, pathology, and prognosis may be known or unknown. Okay. So that diseases, you may call it as viral disease, infectious disease, endemic, parasitic, emerging, obligate, exotic, environmental, opportunistic, bacterial, emergency, okay, over disease or cohort disease, many such names are available. Okay, so let us not go into the details. Okay. So why the diseases are important? This is what important to us. Okay. So when the disease comes, okay, so you will be losing cases, ultimately due to the mortality or morbidity. Okay, you may have to go for a drug application, so that will make you to incur more expenditure. Okay, you'll be losing valuable fishes like ornamental fishes or brooders. Okay, or you may incur a loss of economic loss. Say for example, I can tell you then that according to the World Bank estimate, it is by 2014, it is estimated that okay, the world is losing around $7 billion per annum due to diseases alone in aquatic animal. You can just imagine the magnitude of the loss which the farmers are incurring, losses due to diseases in a global aquaculture scenario. Okay, so ultimately this is going to affect the farmers' confidence on the farming. Okay, not only this, okay, the spread of disease, okay, it is happening, like as in the case of coronavirus. Okay, it is happening from continent to continent. That I will come to the subsequent discussions. Okay. And it also impacts the international trading. When there is a new disease comes, okay, there is an international embargo on the export of the commodities or import of the commodity. Ultimately, so that is affect the. Okay, finally, okay, it is indirectly affects the public health, especially because of the use of drugs, particularly in the one of the most sensitive chemical, with antibiotics. The antibiotics should not be there in any other commodity which is intended for human consumption. Okay. So this is what the importance of the diseases. That's what okay, much importance is given on the diseases. Okay, another statistics I would like to say here is that on an average, the world is losing around 21% of the production due to the diseases alone. You just imagine 21% of the diseases due to the production due to the diseases. So such a colossal loss it is going to cause or it is causing. Okay, so this. Okay, so that's what the discussion here is. There are three major types of diseases that you come across. One is the environmental, due to the presence of environmental pathogen, okay, which may be of, another thing is that low resistance to fish stock, that is the inherent quality of the fish, okay, inherent genetic quality. Okay, another one is the environment, that we call it as, okay, so this right hand side you can see three circles are given. Okay, the top one is and the fishes are happy. You can see the fishes are happy, that shows, okay, all the factors are in balance. Okay, that is the pathogenic conditions, environmental conditions, and the health of the fish, all are happy. When everything is happy, ultimately the farmer is going to be happy, the fish is also going to be happy. If anything changes, this is given here then, okay. Say for example, that extreme down, okay, you can see, so the circles are, okay, this is explained by the complex interaction of the host pathogen and the environment. So three circles, okay, so that center one, you can see that red marking is the disease, okay. So this first one, this is the first one. You can see that the area of covered by the red is the small. Okay, that shows even in healthy condition, okay, the disease is part of aquaculture system. Okay, so this you need to burn in your mind. Okay, even in healthy condition, when everything is normal, okay, so that the diseases are liable to be get diseases. Okay, but if the pathogen level goes up, or the environment level goes up, or the host condition goes abnormal, okay, so ultimately the area is going to be enlarged. So this shows the possibility of getting disease and the possibility of loss is more. So this is what the famous description by the Sinesco, this we call it a Sinesco model of this disease. Okay, so what we need to see here is, okay, so how the host and the environment and pathogen and their interactions are kept minimal. If the environment and the host and the pathogen interaction is kept minimal, so you are going to have a very good harvest. Okay, so before going to the details, I would like to say, okay, what are the likely causes of stress and the responses the fish undergoes. Okay, possibly the major causes which comes from the water quality are the transportation of the fish, the netting of handling, temperature, salinity, water hardness, poor nutrition, or many other factors. Okay, and how the fish responds. Okay, so the first one is sympathetic nervous system activation, that is endocrine system will be activated, ultimately that leads to increase in the cortisol, catecholamine, the heart rate, respiratory rate, okay, osmolarity decreases, and the glucose level goes up. And subsequently, the fish undergoes immunosuppression, leading to the disease resistance, growth rate reduction, reproduction potential goes down. So these are the responses the fish gets. So this will be better explained. Okay, so possibly, okay, this is one of the important things you need to remember. So how to identify the different causative agents based on the mortality pattern. Okay, of course, this is based on, okay, you need to have very good observations on the mortality pattern, okay, which is happening in the aquaculture system. Say for example, the extreme light, okay, the extreme left, I can just start from that bell shape. If you are getting over a period of time, if you are getting the mortality, and if you put in a graph, if you get, okay, perfect bell shape, okay, you can see that it is typical of bacterial diseases. It is not the confirmatory one, it can be 98% you can rely on, okay, this is due to bacteria. And that the bottom one, sigmoidal, if you are getting sigmoidal, this also possibly there may be initial lag phase. Okay, so that pathogens may get some time to get over the, okay, so to overcome the defenses put forth by the fish. Ultimately, this is also due to the bacteria. The bell-shaped as well as sigmoidal curve, so the mortality is most likely due to the bacterial diseases. Okay, another one here, that extreme, okay, on the top right hand side, you can see if you have the plateau shape, okay, it is mostly due to the nutritional disorder. Okay, if the fishes are subjected to nutritional disorder, so you will be having a rise in temperature, rise in mortality, but it will be getting stabilized over a period of time. Okay, say for example, if you are getting the mortality at one time, okay, it goes to a peak instantly. Okay, so that may be due to some kind of presence of chemical or the viral agent. So this is based on, this normally we call it the mortality curve, and based on that we can identify that what exactly the causative agent. Okay, ultimately, that will help us to the diagnosticians to identify what exactly is the cause. Okay, so another example is available here then. Okay, so if you are getting this multiple spikes, okay, it is most likely due to the environmental parameter, especially the low DO, okay, other things. So this can also be put in another theoretical mortality pattern curve. Okay, so say for example, if you are getting slow mortality over that persists for a longer period of time, then you can call it as chronic one, the bottom line. And the second one is that it is subacute, it is neither acute nor chronic. Okay, so medium scale mortality over a period of time. And the third one is, okay, acute mortality. And the last one is a large scale mortality in a short span of time. So it is most likely due to the environmental parameters. Okay, if you are getting the mortality in a short span of time, okay, within say for example night, you may be seeing that morning, so 3 o'clock there may be some problem with reports are found. Okay, the entire population would be died or would maybe die. So such kind of conditions, okay, it is due to the environmental parameter. Okay, based on the mortality, you can tentatively assume that okay, what exactly the causative agent. Okay, again, one of the important thing is that this can be better explained in the next slide. Okay, so of course you need to remember that his health status depends on number of factors. Let me start from the host itself. The host, the fish itself. So the host may vary in terms of species. Say for example, tilapia, carps, or cutla. Within carps, we have different varieties. Okay, everything has got some kind of innate qualities. And the age, that is one of the somatic factor, and even the strength. Okay, so this all this are having that. Okay, and the facilities, and the facility, what kind of facilities you have. So that also going to have some kind of determination on the health status of the animal, particularly on the handling, how the fishes are handled, how the, what is the stocking density, what the design of the farm, what is the design of the hatchery, that is also going to have. And the environment, especially the water quality and the organic load and the temperature, the nutrition, especially the quantity and the quality of the feed which is going to be used for the fish, and the schedule, okay, what, how many time you are giving and what ration you are giving. Say for example, some pieces, especially when it is in the younger stage, it requires more feed. Say for example, when the fish are in the larval stage, it requires more feed than when it is going to the adult stage. Adult stage requires normally 2 to 3%. When the fish are in young stage, it requires more fish. Say for example, in the case of shrimp larvae, it starts from 18% of the body weight. Okay, so simultaneously, when it goes to the adult stage, it comes to 2%. So that also one of the important thing you need to do then. Again, the schedule of feeding. Some fishes requires night feeding, some fishes requires day feeding. So that also affects. And again, with respect to the pathogen, okay, all the microorganisms are not pathogenic. Okay, and whatever pathogenics are there, that also, okay, you may be there. That again depends on the chances. Okay, there are certain pathogens which are opportunistic in nature. Some of them are primary in nature. Okay, this again depending upon this one. Because all the species cannot be infected. Okay, so this again depends on certain strength. Say for example, nowadays, okay, you might have heard about a bacterial disease in shrimp often. Okay, so here it is caused by bacteria. Okay, Vibrio paragammaticus having one specific gene. Okay, that gene. Okay, that will capable enough to cause the disease. Again, the type. See, many serotypes are available. The only specific type serotypes may be having some kind of this one. Another thing is that the physiological state of the fish. This also going to have the greater say on the health status of the animal, particularly. So the fish will have the innate quality, that we call it as natural resistance. Another one is acquired resistance, that artificially it is going to get. Okay, so ultimately all these parameters are going to have physical status. Okay, once you know all about this, okay, the parameters which are going to have the impact on the physical, okay, so that is going to help you in a systematic way to manage that fish. Okay, so this is what, okay, so this is what another pictorial presentation of, okay, how the fishes are getting stressed over a period of time due to the stressors. Okay, so the extreme right, you can see different stressors that we have listed earlier. So any deviations to the normal conditions, okay, leading to some kind of action, and that action going to affect the pituitary action. That pituitary action means the endocrine system. As a result, okay, the ACT gets, okay, the pituitary gland will be activated, leading to the adrenal gland will be, okay, stimulated, leading to the formation of, okay, cortisol. Cortisol is another steroid enzyme, and that will activate the liver, and the liver will is one of the important metabolic organ. Okay, so that will release GTPX. So this is one of the enzyme. Okay, so this is glutathione peroxidase. Glutathione peroxidase and desaturase. Ultimately, all these are going to have some kind of action on the membrane peroxidation. Okay, membrane activity. So okay, the cells will not be getting sufficient enzymes or sufficient proteins for the metabolic activity. Ultimately, fish will have immunologically reduced function. The blood pressure goes down. So that will affect the gill damages and the gill functioning. Ultimately, the pathogens will dominate, and the dominance will lead to the stress. Dominance will lead to the mortality. So this is what normally happening in any aquaculture system when the fishes are subjected to stress. Okay, so this graph, okay, this image shows, okay, how to distinguish from the sick fish from the external, okay, healthy fish. So normally, Okay, so this is only the small observations. Okay, so it is the fish, six fish can be identified based on the activity, body color, body surface, body shape, feed intake and the organs without subjecting the fish to necropsy. It is only through the visual observations, activity of the fish, body color. Normally, many of the fish will have the dark coloration, okay, except in few cases where the fish will be bleached, okay. Except in few cases, the fish will be, most of the cases, the fish will have that darkened body color, okay, and the white layered patches, thin bodies, okay, thinning of the body, that is, we call it as emaciation. The fish will not create a poor appetite, whereas the healthy fish will have all these are normal conditions, okay. Now, let me go into the details, okay. Before you go for the preventive measures or the this one, okay, so you need to, the first thing you need to remember here is that, okay, so you need to identify the disease. Okay, the causative agent of the disease. Unless otherwise you identify the causative agent, you are not going, whatever measures you take, it is not going to give any fruitful result. Okay, so diagnosis is one of the important thing. So if you are able to identify the exact causative agent of the disease, okay, it is going to help you in a systematic way to address the disease problem. Otherwise, okay, whatever you do, it is only the arbitrary ones. Okay, so you may get success or you may not get. Okay, so diagnosis is one of the important thing in the case of aquaculture operations. Okay, not only in aquaculture operation, even in the case of human medicines. Okay, of course, earlier we have been depending upon the microscopic methods, the top one. So normally we go for wet mount, histopathology, bacteriology, bios, and hematology. So these are all very old classical methodologies which you normally any microbiology laboratory follow. Now with the advent of scientific innovations, okay, now the serology methods came into exist. Okay, so here it includes ELISA, IFAT. Okay, that is immunoassay. Okay, then SNT, AGPT, dot plot, okay, LAT, okay, IF, okay, IKC, and many such assays. Now, okay, so we are depending upon the molecular methods. Okay, molecular method like in situ hybridization, PCR, real time PCR, LAMP, and microassay techniques. And very recently, we are looking for the cutting edge technologies, okay, especially next generation sequencing and metagenomics. Okay, these are the recent developments. Okay, all are going to help you to identify what exactly the causative agent. Unless otherwise you identify the causative agent to the possible extent 100%, okay, it is not going to help you in any way. So this is what you need to give a priority for any kind of management practices. Okay, first you identify the disease, and for that identify causative agent, what exactly the treatment requires. Ultimately, that is going to have a greater impact. Okay, so of course, so this again another drive. Okay, so how the diseases are being identified. Okay, so then in laboratory, of course, as per the OAE, we have three kind of classification, three levels of diagnosis. Level one is, that is level one, level two, level three. Okay, it is based on the gross observation. First one is a level observation. It is only your eyesight observation, gross observation that we can see at the palm level. Okay, and the second one is necropsy. Okay, based on the histopathological or wet mount preparation or the basic bacteriological observation. And third one is all advanced methods. Okay, nowadays the confirmation occurs the level three diagnosis. Okay, any diagnostic laboratory, or if you are depending on, if you are put forth any new observations, okay, your results must be validated with molecular methods. Okay, then only it will be accepted. So these are the approaches we normally think about in the diagnosis of the diseases. Okay, of course, this is another development in the observation. First, it started with the microscopic, then histopathology, microbiological observation, immunological techniques, okay, morphological. Nowadays, we stand with nanotechnological approaches in the development of disease diagnosis and also the health management. Okay, so these are the developments which you can see. Then I'm not going into the detail because the time given is only one hour. So I will try to complete the entire thing in this short span of time. Okay, if any further discussions are needed, we can discuss after the lecture is over. Okay, so now we can see, okay, many such diseases are reported. Okay, more than 1,000 diseases are available in the aquaculture system. Possibly, maybe knowing that as per the recent aquaculture report, there are about more than 584 aquaculture species are being cultured throughout the world. Okay, in that recent aquaculture report, more than 584 aquatic animals. Aquatic animal, including aquatic plants, okay, it is being cultured, and many are subjected to different diseases. Okay, so those are all classified by, okay, an international organization called OAE, that is Office International des Epizootics, that is a French term. Okay, so literal translation, English translation is, okay, World Organization for Animal Health. So they put forth the diseases, okay, and the methodologies for the disease diagnosis, because these are the list of diseases. Let me not go into the diseases. Okay, it is broadly classified as kinfish diseases, molluscan diseases, crustacean diseases, and amphibian diseases. Of course, here again, one is listed diseases. Okay, one has to, a country's member countries has to comply. Another one is non-listed diseases, non-OIE listed diseases. But there are, that normally we call it as diseases of national importance or regional importance. Okay, so you need to know, okay, why the diseases are increasing. Okay, so possibly you know that, okay, by 2050, the world population is expected to reach 10 billion. Okay, in order to feed the 50 billion human population, which are going to reach by 2050, we need to think about, okay, augmenting the aquaculture production. So that augmentation of aquaculture production requires intensive aquaculture practices. Okay, when you are going for increasing the aquaculture production through intensified means, okay, you need to have, okay, lot of innovations. So that innovations leads to a lot of, okay, problems. Okay, so that's what increase in aquaculture production through translocation of the aquatic animal from one country to another country. Okay, of course, the best example is vanami. Okay, the Pinaeus vanami, which is not a native species, which has come from, which has come from the Central America. So that has been it has shifted here and re-established in aquaculture conditions, in Indian conditions. So that kind of diseases, that kind of translocation leads to the migration of that animal from one place to another, leading to the transfer of pathogens also from one country, continent to another continent. Okay, so that's what expanding range of new formed aquatic animals. Okay, not only that, I have given an example of vanami, exotic, many of the exotic options, even Nile tilapia, and many other marine animals. So those are all newly introduced. Okay, so that is bringing new pathogens into the new environment. And then new production approaches also available. One such example is that, IMPA, normally we call it a IMTA. Okay, so another one is that we have improved diagnostic and surveillance measures. Okay, I will give an example. Since 2010, the government of India is giving much emphasis on the surveillance. Okay, possibly 2017, there was a report on the surveillance on the Indian condition, because the surveillance has led to identification of many new diseases in Indian condition, notably the Cyprinus aspervirus 2, that is the infectious myonecrosis virus, then another one is tilapia-like virus. These are the important viruses that has been reportedly present in Indian conditions. So these are some of the developments because of the transfer of aquatic animals from one region to another region. So ultimately, the spread, the transfer of animals from one continent to another continent, the transfer of spread of diseases, it is the most feared threat in aquaculture. Okay, so I can give an example, another example, so that you can identify. So possibly you can see that this is a record of EUS, that is episodic ulcerative syndrome. It started its journey as mycotic granuloma. Okay, so that time it was in Japan, 1971. It started its journey in 1971 in Japan. It reached Australia, Queensland in 1922, but it had different name. That time it was called as red spot disease. Okay, then in 1975 it reached Papua New Guinea. 1988 it reached India in northeastern state. 1991 it reached Tamil Nadu and these other places. 96 it is Pakistan. Now in 2021 it has reached the African countries. Okay, so it is still migrating. It is still migrating because of the movement of aquatic animals from one region to another. Okay, and the movement of the people and the migratory birds. Okay, so these are all having a major role in the transfer of aquatic animals. Okay, so this is one of the classical example of the migration of the diseases from continent to continent, okay, starting from one place to another place. Okay, so these are the conditions. Okay, so this, unless otherwise you know all about this in and out of the aquatic animal and the interaction, okay, it is very difficult to manage that thing. Okay, so the management of the diseases, this is one of the delicate issue. Okay, so it is like walking on a sharp edge. Okay, on the sharp edge, it is like walking on a sharp edge. Okay, so this image clearly depicts, how you need to sensibly balance, based on the environment. Okay, the pathogen level goes up, so this will go up, the host defense mechanism goes down. If it is stronger, host mechanism is stronger, pathogen level is ideal, environment is ideal, so you can have a very good balancing. Okay, so this concept must be born in your mind so that you can easily manage this aquatic animals easily. Okay. Of course, when you are coming about the health management, of course, different approaches are available, starting from chemotherapy, use of antibiotic, and many aquatics are available. If you can see the Coastal Aquaculture Authority website, okay, there are more than 2,000, more than 3,000 products have been enlisted in that one. Okay. So you can think about farm management through biosecurity and good management practices, okay, especially that is being followed in shrimp aquaculture, particularly vaname. Then vaccination, of course, in Indian condition, vaccination is not that common, but many of the countries where the salmon is produced, trout is produced, vaccination is one of the organized programs. Okay. And another thing is the nutritional management. Okay, so this is well versed with respect to shrimp farming, especially the use of probiotic, prebiotic, immunostimulant, that is common. And nowadays, okay, people are, after most of them are in experimental state, commercially it has not come, okay, especially the fast therapy. Fast therapy, okay, so say for example, I can give an example regarding that shrimp farming, okay, the luminous fibrosis. So there is a bacterium called luminous Vibrio carbi. Okay, so the fodges are available and the components are available. It has not been commercialized to the major extent, of course. So this, if it is available in a larger scale for commercialization, okay, so this is going to have a greater impact on the specific pathogen, so that pathogenic impact, but due to the particular pathogen, it can be managed. And another thing is the bacuosin. The bacuosins are the chemical compound produced by the probiotic organism. These are low molecular weight substances which can be produced. And the another one is RNAi. Okay, so this again, it is not, nothing but the gene silencing. It is nothing but the genes, and the specific virulent genes can be silenced. Okay, so many such technologies are available. Okay, so the judicious use of these technologies, that is going to harness the fish health in a systematic way. So that's what we are going to see. And let me start from the beginning. Okay. How to look for the prevention? Okay, let me start from the doll. Okay, so the bottom doll, you can see that, okay, it is looking safe. It is looking safe, and just above that, okay, it is slightly squeezed. Okay, you can see that, okay, the ears are coming out. Okay, the ear is coming out of the normal structure. Okay, as long as you are keeping the environment optimally well, aquaculture system is kept optimally well. Okay, you are going to have a very good thing. Okay, and if we are going for intensification, we are going to have a lot of problems. That's what given in the second one. You can see that the air is projecting out. Okay, so this is what normally happens. You need to have a proper preventive measure. Okay, so you need to have the proper stocking situation, proper management practices, and ideal water treatment system. Okay, ideal water quality conditions. Okay, anything which is going beyond that optimal level, that is going to have a impact on this aquatic animal. Okay, so this is what important, that this how this can be prevented. So you can think about the sanitation and quarantine. Okay, let me not go into the details. The sanitation means you can treat the water. Okay, or quarantine means any fish comes, okay, you can isolate it. Okay, possibly now that we are living in the COVID era, so people may be knowing that what exactly the quarantine means. Okay, so normally the quarantine lasts for about 3 weeks. Okay, 3 weeks it is given. Normally it lasts for about 3 to 4 weeks. Okay. And we have that the set of guidelines, okay, that we call it as good aquaculture practices. Okay, that can be, of course, that can be followed. Of course, the GAP varies with the system, species, the recommended stocking season, and also the region where the farming is conducted. Okay, so each location, so what is applied in aquaculture in Bengal may not be applicable to Andhra Pradesh, or what is applicable in Andhra Pradesh may not be applicable in Gujarat. Okay, each condition, we need to have the good aquaculture practices. And there are many such technologies are available to reduce the pathogen. The best example is that, so the age-old practice is that, okay, every culture operation, the pond must be dry. Okay, so that, of course, scientifically it has been proved that the pond is dry for three months. See, a maximum of 3 months, a minimum of 21 days. Okay, this is going to have a greater impact. Okay, that is going to have the sterilizing effect. Okay, so that can be done, followed by disinfection. Then you can go for treatment with some kind of chemicals like formaldehyde at a ratio of 1:400 dilution that can be used. Okay, so this is one kind of things, and this is what method of preventing the entry of pathogens, which has been established for the EES prevention. Okay, let me not, of course, you can see here. Okay, so this is the pond system. Center one is the pond system. What kind of methods are available for this? So starting from the fish, which come from the different sources, that must be sterilized. Fish tank must be sterilized. Fish pond must be disinfected. Water supply must be from the tube well, not from the open system. farm worker, that must be, they must disinfect their hand, okay, and their foot, and the both farm visitors should not be allowed. Even if they visit, they should disinfect. Wild fishes should be excluded. Birds and mammals that should be excluded. Equipment that must be sterilized. Okay, this, all this must be made. So if you are maintaining this, you will be having very good management system. So that we call it as, okay, nowadays, okay, so we have a very pakka system on biosecurity. So you are going to have a security through biological means. Okay, so this, what is that approach? Okay, what is that approach? Okay, it is mainly to aim to reduce the risk of disease introduction. Okay, so of course it is targeting any specific pathogen, and the risk, you need to identify the risk, and based on that identification, you need to reduce the risk. How to reduce the risk? That's what. Okay, so minimize the spread at the farm level or to new area, and to promote the fiscal and protect the economic improvement. Okay, so investment, okay, especially the reputation of the farm. Okay, and protect against the new diseases in a particular system. Okay, so what are the principle? Okay, the principle here is that you need to identify the hazard. So the biosecurity identifies the hazard. Say for example, I can give an example in the case of Vanami. So the hazard has been identified as, okay, Tara syndrome, okay, or white spot diseases, okay, white spot diseases. Okay, the biosecurity hatchery will produce the pathogen specific pathogen free larvae. What is a specific pathogen? It may be either WSV or Tara syndrome virus. Okay, if that is that one, okay, it will not be produced for all the pathogen. It will be targeting any one specific pathogen which is going to have a greater impact on the aquatic animal. Okay, so you need to identify this one. Then you need to assess the impact. Okay, assess the risk. Okay, how it is going to affect the farm level. Okay, and determine the biosecurity measures. What kind of measures you need to follow? So that must be given a priority. It is like the do's and don'ts. Okay, so this is what one of the important thing is, that I am giving an example of disease transmission. Okay, so how the disease, you must know the biology of the disease transmission. Okay, how it gets transmitted. Okay, it may be coming from the vertical or horizontal. Okay, or it may be coming from the predatory birds or the pets or the animal, or it may go through the feed. Okay, or some of the pathogens are zoonotic. Okay, it may affect the human being. Okay, so it may come from the water. Okay, water means, okay, maybe input. Okay, so the farmite means inanimate objects. Okay, especially the equipment, that is nets, buckets, siphons, the footwear, and the clothing and vehicles. Okay, so that are coming into the farm vicinity. So this is what important here. Then, so you need to have some kind of fundamental aspects to see that how the disease is transmitted, and you must watch everything like a security. Okay, and identify the culprit and see that, okay, that is not entering in your system. Okay, so this is what important here, that I show in a pictorial manner. So the disease may occur either from the vertical transmission or horizontal transmission. Vertical means from the father and mother to the babies, or from the fish to fish, or from the water or some other nets. Okay, so these are the pictorial way of transmission of the diseases. Okay, so ultimately, if you understand the nature of the disease, how it is going to get transmitted. Okay, so you need to have a greater planning. Okay, so that is going to help the management practices. Okay, so this has been identified. So the risk factor, the major risk factor in the case of disease introduction is that movement of the fish from one place to another. That is incoming fish or incoming eggs. Egg transportation is not common in Indian condition, but many of the Western countries. Okay, so the green-eyed eggs will be transported from one place to another. Okay, or the fertilizers will be transported, and the water sources and the fiscal equipment, vehicles and vectors, maybe animal or human being or inanimate matter. All these are having some kind of risk that need to be identified. Okay. So this, let me not go into the details regarding this. So this, you need to, okay, the prevent, how to prevent it. Okay, so the movement of the fish. Okay, so fish movement. So you need to have to procure the fish from the healthy, you need to procure the fish from, you have healthy fish. Okay, there are certain technologies identify how the fish can be identified as a good one or the bad one. Okay, and that must be pathogen specific, pathogen free. Okay, you must have the certified seeds must be from the one. And when it comes to the new environment, okay, it must be quarantined. The quarantine here, it is given 4 to 6 weeks. Normally it is maximum 4 weeks. Okay, so the quarantine must be given. Then this is what, okay, on reaching it, okay, on reaching or before you do it, okay, what you can do is, this is what, again, I am pictorially representing it that, so you need to have a very thorough watch on the pathogen. Okay, so a thorough check on the pathogen, okay, either by your laboratory facilities or through depending on outsourcing, okay, the laboratory report you need to get okay, and we can think of vaccination. Okay, and another thing is that it's an EU-approved farm model. So here it says, okay, you should not take that water from the surface water. Okay, it must be taken from the groundwater or the well water. Okay, and the fish must not be taken in an uncertified form. It must be certified. Okay, when it is certified, you can take it to the farm condition. Okay, so every fish you take, it must have the certificate for the specific pathogen free. Of course, it is not possible in the case of fin fishes in Indian condition, but many of the shell fishes, particularly vaname and monodon, details are available. Specific pathogen status are available, so that can be implemented. Okay, so in Indian condition, it is also available. So that is one of the approaches. Another important thing is that, okay, in many things, especially in the case of West Bengal, okay, so there is a practice of multiple stocking and multiple harvesting. Okay, so economically, the farmers may think that multiple stocking and multiple harvesting is economically viable, but scientifically, it is not. Okay, it is not that good because, okay, if you are taking a fish from source A, so it will carry the microorganism from the source A alone. But if you are taking the larvae or the fry from different sources, you are having sources of microorganism from five different origin, and that is going to have a greater impact on the aquatic ecosystem, especially the microbes from the five different ecosystem will be coming, and that will have ultimately the fish in the pond will have the microflora from five different places, and the chance factor for the getting the diseases is increased by 5 times. Okay, so this is what important here is that. Okay, so whenever you take the fish, at once, only one places and stock at only one time. If it is done, so you are going that the risk transfer of diseases risk is minimized because you are going to get pathogen from only one source. That can be easily managed. If you are taking the pathogen from different sources, that is going to have a greater problem to the aquatic system. Okay, so this again water sources, many such resources are available for the treatment of water. Okay, so that can be thought, especially in the case of shrimp farming, ozonation, especially in the case of hatcheries, ozonation and ultraviolet radiations or the filtration facilities are available. That can be thought of, especially in the case of ornamental fishes. Also, this is the Australian technology. Okay, so that they depend on disinfection of water supply and filtration of water. This is an organized technique. Okay, so another thing is that fish health. This is also one of the important thing. So you need to have that optimum health condition for the aquatic animal. So that is also one of the important thing you need to think about. Okay. Then prevention. So you need to have the water. You need to have a small laboratory in the farm vicinity to check the water quality so that optimum water can be maintained. Okay. So you need to have proper monitoring of the physical chemical parameters, and whatever feed you give, so that must be a good quality. Say for example, cod may require 25% protein. Okay, whereas in the case of shrimps or the catfishes, they may require 40 to 45% protein. So according to that the protein demand, the fishes are to be fed. Say for example, a calf, if it is fed 40% protein, okay, so you are going to waste the protein. And if you are giving catfishes the 24% protein, you are not going to get a very good harvest. Okay, so this is also one of the important things. So what kind of fishes are you are culturing? According to the biology, you need to identify what is the protein requirement for the particular animal. Accordingly, you need to plan it. Okay, and what kind of essential nutrients are needed? That also to be provided. Okay, there's particularly the vitamins or the organic growth factors. Okay, or some other minerals that must be available in sufficient quantities. Okay. So the prevention of fiscals, that is also one of the important thing. For that, you need to have a monitoring. Okay, monitoring means I don't think that, okay, you need to have the level 3 diagnostic laboratory at your farm level. Level 1 diagnosis, that is more than sufficient. That is through your eyesight. Okay, so based on the movement of the fish, okay, based on the behavior of the fish, you can identify whether the fishes are active or inactive. Okay, so that can be done. If there is any inactive condition, so immediately you can report to the nearby laboratory. Okay, so then you can get your analysis done, okay, so that the proper treatment can be managed. Okay, so this is what important. Another important thing is that fomite. So fomite means, okay, inanimate objects that is commonly used in the case of farming system, particularly the nets, the buckets, hoses, boots, waders, and this one. Okay, every hatchery or every farm, every pond should have only one net. Okay, so the net should not be repeatedly used for other purpose. For example, if you are using that one equipment for one pond or one hatchery, so that must be used for this one. So that will be the motto in your this one. That will be useful not to transfer that aquatic and pathogen from one system to another system. Okay, so this is very simple. So it is a small technology. It does not require any chemical or anything. Simple IQ. Okay, so with simple techniques, you can manage that the transfer of diseases. Okay, then proper protocol, cleaning protocol must be there. Then okay, so that's this proper cleaning must be there. Then here again, organizedly it must be done. Then okay, so remove all the visible debris. Okay, it must be there. Using, we must use soap and water to rinse. Okay, especially after the draining that water, it must be dried. Okay, this is normal practice in the case of hatcheries. Okay, and the disinfectant solution, appropriate concentration should be used. Okay, and it must be rinsed and neutralized. Say, for if you are using bleaching powder, that must be neutralized with sodium thiosulfate. Okay, so otherwise the chlorine has got the ability to form chloramine, and chloramine is also toxic to the larvae. Okay, so these are some of the standard disinfectants that are available, and the available doses are available. So this can be any literature, book, standard books, these details are available. At right concentration, if we can use. Hello. Correct. Hello. Then comes the risk factor. Another risk factor through the vectors. Okay, say the birds, the aquatic animals. Okay, which rodents. Okay, and the people. Okay, the unwanted people who enter in the farm facility. They are also the carriers of the diseases. Okay, so these are the there. So normally, what you need to do is many of the shrimp farms. You can see that okay, these labels will be available. Do not enter, or the farm visitor policies you need to have them. So these are some of the things you need to have. So this kind of crowding in the community farms, okay, it is possible, but in many of the organized farm sectors, okay, so they will be having this proper. So these are some of the technologies, simple techniques we need to follow to prevent the entry of the pathogen. Okay, and another important thing is that implementation. Okay, the implementation, you need to have a very good communication with the technicians. Okay, and you have a very good return plan. Okay, and reassessment if there is anything goes wrong. Okay, you need to reassess accordingly. Okay, so these are some of the. This is nothing but okay, some of the and okay, good GAP. So good aquaculture practices or BMP. So better management practices. Okay, so this is nothing but okay, the HACCP. The hazard identification and critical control point. Okay, HACCP implementations only then. So this is what important. Okay, so this is what normally I'm giving you some kind of pictorial presentation. Many of the Western countries, they have the tank hygiene and the daily cleaning and maintaining, and records will be properly maintained. Okay, so this is in the case of hatchery and that equipment. So biosecurity laboratory here. Okay, and you need to have a very good laboratory for water quality analysis and simple water and physicochemical analysis. Okay, and this is about the aquaculture, what the aquaculture industry needs. Okay, so you need to have very good chemotherapeutic agent, particularly antimicrobial is one of the sensitive compound. Okay, antimicrobial or antiparasitic or anything which are used for the pathogenic, so this is one of the sensitive one. So okay, it is one of the most debated topic, because it is going to affect the human health. Okay, it is going to affect the human health. It is subjected to regulatory measures. Okay, many other antibiotics. Okay, so aquaculture products which is intended for human consumption should not have the traces of antibiotic. Okay, and now we have the technologies for vaccines. Many such vaccines are available. Many such anesthesia materials are available. Okay, and biosecurity measures are available. So that must be judiciously utilized. Of course, it is available for few cases like salmon and some of the important species. Okay, say for example, carps, nothing is available. Shrimps, some of the important shrimps, it is available, like menane and monodon, still it is under experimentation. Pinnaeus indicus, it is not available, still on experimentation. Okay, and we may require a good amount of immunostimulation modulators and alternate treatment methods, like use of probiotic, not treatment methods, preventive methods. Okay, prebiotic, biological control using some kind of okay, antimicrobial biological agent and diagnostic kits. Okay, so what are the developments? So globally, many such diagnostic kits are available. Okay, so these are some of them are available even in Indian conditions. With nowadays, people may be knowing that even handheld PCR machines are available. Handheld PCR machines are available. So that has revolutionized, because the farmers can easily test the presence of particular pathogen in this, and accordingly they can decide what exact managing measures they should think about. Okay, so many such manufacturers are available globally. So this I have given a few examples, and the treatment is also available, but treatment is the last resort. Okay, so chemotherapy is available, you start chemical antibiotics that can be followed, immunotherapy is available, prebiotic or prebiotics are available. Okay, but everything depends upon, okay, of course, four case. Okay, the four case means you must know the biology of the fish, and you must know the chemistry of the water, physical chemical property of the water, you must know the chemistry of the chemical, and know the diseases. If all the four case are known, not case, CASES, 4K case. Okay, know the fish, know your water, know your chemical, know your disease. If all these are known, then only you can go for treatment. Otherwise, the treatment is not going to fetch you any very good result. Okay, treatment is not going to be get very better, very good result. Okay, it is going to be a waste. Okay, so many such medicinal products are available in the commercially. Of course, I put a question mark here. Then, of course, it is that success is very debatable. Success is very much debatable. Okay, it is a big question. Let me not go into the details. Okay, of course, many such technologies are available. You can think about disinfection of the eggs. Okay, at the hatchery level. Okay, so of course, chemicals are available. Ovadine. Okay, so this kind of cell iodine-based compound. Okay, possibly you can see here. Okay, iodine can be used for treatment of the fish. Say for example, one volume of eggs with 10 volume of disinfectant solution that can be used. Okay. Of course, it is normally followed in the case of many of the Western countries, particularly salmonella trout. Okay, and these are some of the eggs of the salmon, particularly the salmon. You can see the fungal infection. Okay, so say for example, here they advise you to remove the dead eggs. When the number of eggs are dead, okay, the white color ones are indicating that beyond treatment. So that must be disinfected. Okay, so totally discarded. Okay. So this, you can also think about formalin treatment or hydrogen peroxide. Many such technologies are available for the treatment of the eggs. This starts from the hatchery, okay, so that you will get, okay, that the progeny which you are getting, going to get for the distribution channel, that is a very good product. Okay, and you can also think about biology. Okay, so immune system, so you can augment the immune development. Okay, so this can be done by, okay, two ways. Okay, that is innate, improving the innate immunity, that is not specific immunity, and also think of vaccination, that is adaptive immunity. Okay, so many such things are available, many such technologies are available, many such commercial products are available. Possibly I can again advise you to get into the website of CAA. So more than 3000 products are available. Most of the products are immunomodulators. That has been approved for use in Indian aquaculture system. Okay, so this helps to minimize the damage of the tissues. Okay, that will help to foster healing, reduce the impact of infection on health. Of course, it is not the treatment measures, it is the preventive measures. Okay, the immune system, augmenting the immune system, it's not a treatment measures, it is going to have the preventive measures. Okay, then, so this about the vaccination programs which are available in the world. Okay, so in 1992, okay, two commercially available vaccines were available. Now by 27, it is increased to 26. 2007, it is increased to 26 because of the fact that it is going to have very good economic benefits, economical benefits, environmental benefits, and animal welfare benefits. Okay, so these are some of the benefits on the fish vaccines. Okay, possibly in Indian condition, not many good vaccines are available because many of the pathogens in Indian conditions are not primary pathogens. Okay, so we need to have a very good primary pathogens. Okay, so we can generate the vaccines for primary pathogens. Okay, opportunity pathogens may not be useful. Okay, opportunity pathogens like a Aeromonas. Okay, it's not useful because these are all waterborne pathogens, normal waterborne microorganisms. Okay, it's not data. Nowadays, okay, more than 30-40 commercial vaccines are available for use in aquaculture. Most of them are available for the Western species, not in Indian condition. Okay, of course, the vaccines can be delivered in a different ways: immersion, injection, oral. Okay. And the new diseases are available. New vaccines are also coming into the picture, okay, like Vibrio angularum, Francisella, Edwardsella tada, and now Edwardsella tada. Now it has been, of course, divided into two species, okay, especially the Edwardsella tada, which infects the fish. It is renamed as Edwardsella piscicida, okay, and Tenacibaculum martinus, okay, it is another species which is affecting the marine fish. okay, arrange it. Okay, these are some of the new diseases that has been reported, and vaccines also being developed for this kind of species. Okay, of course, now in the case of salmon industry, and of course, it has become a very good organized vaccination program since 1990. Okay, so they have commercialized through in a very good organized way. So this pictorial images depicts how organized way the fingerlings and the flies are vaccinated at the cage structures. Okay, so these are about the dip vaccination in fingerlings. Okay, not only the dip vaccination, so they also perfected the technology of injection. Okay, injection methods. So this about the injection. So within short span of time, so they can inject hundreds and thousands of vaccines. So they have semi-automated system. Okay, the fishes are normally euthanized. Anesthetized. Okay, it is not euthanized. It is anesthetized. Okay, at appropriate dose of MSG. It's okay. So the fishes were transported in a conveyor belt. Okay, so people will be standing, and they will be through the machine gun, electric gun. Okay, they will be vaccinating. So most of the vaccine is done by intraperitoneal means. Okay, so these are a very organized way of doing the salmon farming in many of the Western countries, okay, especially in Norway and other countries. Okay, so these are the vaccine technologies. Many of you may be aware of it. So the vaccines are of a simple inactivated recombinant DNA vaccine and gene silencing that I was telling about, the RNAi technology. Okay, and VLP vaccine, that is virus-like particles, and live modified vaccines. Mostly now we might be having about the Covaxin in the case of corona. So these are some of the live modified vaccines. Okay, so now, so we have technology for immunostimulants. Many such compounds are available for immunomodulators for aquaculture. More than 30 commodities are available. Okay, but you need to assess the cost-benefit ratio. Okay, and it should comply the regulatory issues. Okay, so many of the immunostimulants available in Indian conditions are imported from the many of the Western countries. Okay, so they are not subjected to the regulatory issues. Okay, whether it is successful or not, that is also a big question. Whether it is beneficial in terms of cost. Okay, that is also unsuccessful. Okay. So the immunostimulants may be specific as well as non-specific. Yes, the specific one is nothing but the vaccines. Non-specific one is okay, which improve the innate immunity. Okay, and the probiotics. Okay, so here again a multi-dollar after multi-dollar industry, after multi-million questions are available. Okay, for regarding this authenticity of this application. Okay, so many may claim that okay, it is good. Many are claiming that it is not that good. Okay, this again depending upon how it adjusts to the local condition. Okay, so normally the microbial population from the native condition stands better than the microorganism from the faraway conditions, okay, alien conditions. So that is one of the important thing you need to remember. Okay, so this again depend on the probiotic application, depend upon the bacterial dynamics. So this is what normally happens in the case of aquaculture system. Okay, the bacterial dynamics, any aquaculture system, okay, where there is no probiotic conditions. When there is no probiotic conditions, you will be having a greater amount of general microorganism. Okay, so the background microorganisms will be having larger biological diversity. When you are having stabilizing effect using probiotic, okay, you are going to have limited diversity. This is what the scientific principle behind the use of probiotic. Okay, so that is going to give a water stability, because the unstabilized microbial population is curtailed in the case of probiotic addition. So this ultimately, you know that okay, many of the diseases are happening due to the opportunity pathogens or the primary pathogens. Okay, when you are having that population under control, making use of the stabilizing effect of the probiotic organism, you are going to have a very good harvest. So this is what the scientific principle behind the use of this one. Again, the crustaceans basically they are immunologically weak. Okay, so they depend, okay, 80% of the innate immunity depends on innate immunity. That is, okay, it is not specific immunity. So that you need to depend. So many of the animals have to depend on the probiotics or microbiological maturation. This again a new technology. So aging the water and maturing the water with the desired microorganisms. So that is also possible, especially in the case of crustacean culture, particularly the shrimp aquaculture. So this is one. Then another one is that improving the larval resistance. This is again So a lot of emphasis is given on recent years, okay, especially the broodstock management. So if the broodstocks are given very good nutritious food, okay, immunostimulation and vaccination and good food, okay, that's what broodstock feed management is one of the important aspects that need to be covered. Okay, when you are having a very good broodstock, ultimately the babies which you are get, the eggs and the semen quality which you are going to get is of good quality. Ultimately, the end product, the product egg quality are of good. Okay, so that will resist very good one. Another thing is that broodstock selection is also one of the important thing. That is the selective breeders, selective breeding. Okay, that rods, especially the resistant stocks must be given preference over the sensitive stocks. This is susceptible stocks over the resistant. Okay, the breeding programs. Okay, the breeding program. That is also one of the important things. So many of the things. Okay, it is being done, especially in the case of shrimps. Okay, not only the technology is called high health shrimp. The technology name is called high health. So that need to be given much preference. Okay, high health shrimp. Okay, that is important. Okay, so that is an organized industry in the case of Guinness Benami production, high health shrimp. Okay, so that is depending upon the improvement of the larval resistance by selective breeding. Okay, so that is also then another thing is the larval nutrition. That is also one of the important thing. So you need to think about how to. Okay, this is considered the new tool in improving the production. Okay, through the nutritional strategies. Okay, the stress management, microbiological control, use of probiotics and prebiotics, and mineral dependent or enzyme pathway. You need to understand the enzyme pathway, then plan accordingly. Okay, so this is again another technological advancement that are coming in the recent one. And and we can also think about the water maturation. The water maturation, normally what is happening here is that, okay, so you need to treat the water by biological filter. Okay, water treatment, preliminary water treatment, then biological treatment, then that biologically treated water will have desired microorganism that will be circulated among the different aquaculture system. So this is for the pictorial presentations. Okay, I'm not going to the details regarding how it is being done. Okay, so but it is one of the technology. Another one is water recirculation. This is also possible. It's also viable technology. So this, the water must be treated with sand filter, but then it must be biofiltered, then UV treated, then it must be circulated. Okay, so this is what it is happen. This is what normally happen in the case of water recirculation. Nowadays people are thinking about the bioflux technology. And of course, bioflocculant technology is nothing to do with water recirculation, but RA system also coming into picture in many of the Indian conditions, particularly in the fast growing species. Okay, so these are some of the preventive measures we need to think about. Okay, so I'm putting in a nutshell. So you need to give more emphasis on the genetics. Okay, so the species which are going to culture should be of high quality, okay, immune vigor. Okay, should have high quality immune vigor product, because genetically it must be stronger and must be immunized. The feed quality which are going to use in aquaculture system must be good. You must reduce the stocking density, reduce the stress, and dietary supplement must be of good. And you must use antibiotic when it is needed. That too at the early stage of culture operation. And the water quality must be of good throughout the culture operation. These are some of the preventive measures you need to follow. And the protective measures, what you need to do here is that the hygienic conditions, the all over the culture operation, so all through the culture operation, it should have the good hygiene. Okay, you need to prevent the vector and the pests. Okay, then the SPF stocks, SPF feeds and SPF water and other things must be that. There is specific pathogen. It need not be the larvae. It must be feed. It must be a water that must be there then. Okay, and you must have the handle over the wild fish. Okay, have a very good quarantine. Of course, it is not all the time. It is not possible when you are procuring the new stocks in the larval farms. Okay, so that must be quarantined before it is introduced into the aquaculture system. Okay, and the age and size. Okay, whenever you stock the fish in a particular system, it must be of uniform size and uniform age. Okay, and another thing is the transplant regulation. Transplant regulation, of course, it is not applicable in Indian condition. Okay, but many of the ornamental fishes, genetically modified microorganisms, fishes are available. Possibly, you may be knowing about ornamental fish, glowfish. Okay, so this is one. That is the transplant regulation. That is inserting specific gene. That is genetically modified fish. Okay, so one best example is glowfish, which are available in ornamental industry. Okay, another thing is that, okay, now very recently, in a couple of years back, the Canadian government has legally permitted the introduction of genetically modified salmon, which grows. It is a transgenic fish. It's a transgenic fish, specifically transgenic salmon, which grows 2.5 times more than the normal salmon. Okay, so normal salmon, if it grows 1 kg in a particular period of time, within the same period, the genetically modified organism can grow to a level of 2.5 kg. So these are the approaches the scientists are working on. Okay, so those kind of measures are to be thought about. Okay, so this, of course, this topic, today's presentation, of course, the title of the program is on rural aquaculture. Okay, I'm giving some input on the rural aquaculture, how it can be identified, especially for the better management practices for the crops. Okay, so this is based on my observation. Okay, so I have identified through some kind of software based on the questioning, based on the questions put forth by me to the farmers, and getting that answer, and that has been fed to the software, and I got that information. Okay, so based on that, I have identified two kind of factors. One is sparing factor. Sparing factor means, so which is going to help the farmers to overcome the disease or to minimize the disease. Okay, and the putative factors are the one which is going to affect greatly the farmers in terms of diseases. Okay, so let us see what are the sparing factors. If the farmers are using the rain water, okay, so the farmers are going to get very good yield. Okay, then draining the pond water once in a year. So after the culture operation, the pond water is totally drained. Okay, then it is considered as a sparing factor. Okay, so then after draining, if the pond was dried for more than 20 days, okay, so that disease incidence is getting reduced. And the liming the pond bottom, okay, after drying, it must be lined. Then the seed must be treated before stocking. Okay, that normally no people will be doing it. So normally the KMNO4 dip or salt water dip must be given. Okay, or even, okay, some other chemicals can be used for treating the fish before stocking. So that can also be thought of. Okay, so that will reduce the introduction of the pathogen into the new system. Then drying and disinfection of the fishing nets. Okay, every month you will be going for sampling. Okay, so with the net, either the cast net or the drag net, the net must be disinfected and drained properly. Okay, and the farmers who are trained in aquaculture, so they were able to manage the farming operation in a better and systematic way than the farmers who were not trained. Okay, these are identified some of the sparing factor, and that is going to have greater effect on the carp aquaculture. And the putative factors include the presence of wild fish. If the farms are rich in wild fish, okay, that is going to have a greater problem. And the use of sewage water and the intensification in aquaculture practices and the use of more number of grow ponds in a farm complex, that is very difficult to manage. Okay, and use of the poor maintenance of nursery ponds, okay, that is also a problem. And the pond bottom is black in color, so that's also a problem. Okay, especially that will have anaerobic system, that is black soil is because of the HTS formation and anaerobiasis is not that problematic. Okay, it's not good. Okay, it's a problematic. Okay, so that will scavenge the nitrate and nitrogen. Okay, ultimately the nitrogen will be removed. Okay, so primary productivity will be affected. Okay, so that leads to stimulates the denitrification process. Okay, that sludge disposal on the pond dike. Okay, whenever you remove the black bottom and if you put that soil for the pond preparation, so that is also, yeah, one of the bad practices. Okay, and the high fish seed mortality during the transportation. Whenever you bring the fish and during the transportation, the large number of fish dies. Okay, that's an indication that the seeds are of poor quality. Okay, and the inclusion of bottom dwelling fishes in the case of pond, especially Mirgal and Labia bottom as cultural species. Okay, especially this is true in the case of Andhra Pradesh. Many of the Andhra Pradesh carp culture farms, okay, they may not be stocking Mirgala or Bata. The reason is that, okay, they are highly susceptible to EUS. Okay, so they stock mostly the Rohu and Katla. So this is one of the observation by the Andhra Pradesh farmers. Okay, so they exclude some of the sensitive species. That is, sensitive species will be excluded. Okay, and another thing is that sudden drop in temperature also some of the has been identified as putative factors. Okay, so these are some of the sparing factors and putative factors which the illiterate farmers can follow, which does not require any of the sophistications. Okay, So with this is what I wanted to conclude. Okay, so as I said, in the second or third slide, I said, okay, the disease is part of aquaculture. Disease is part of aquaculture. The threat to infectious diseases to aquaculture will continue to happen. Okay, so you need to mentally prepare to face it. Okay, so one thing you need to do is, okay, you need to have a proper security mechanism, security method, or monitoring system. Okay, it does not mean that, okay, so you need to have a pakka security measures, biosecurity measures, as it is practiced in many of the salmon aquaculture farms, or in the case of Pineus venami hatcheries, okay, or Pineus venami grow farms, okay, it does not require, but at least if you can have some kind of minimum security measures, that is going to help to prevent the disease introduction and the spread, okay. So it is in on our hand to protect our fish, for our farm, our health. Of course, our health is that many of the pathogens are human pathogens too, especially Edwardsella tada. Okay, Edwardsella tada. So it's a human pathogen as well as animal pathogen. Aeromonas hydrophila, it is both human pathogen and animal pathogen. Okay, ultimately, it is going to have a greater say on the human health. Okay, another thing is that, okay, so if the disease comes, it is going to have the investment loss. Okay, investment loss. Any farmer will not be losing, tend to lose the investment. Okay, so this is what important here is that, okay, so this is what important here is that, okay, you need to have three things. Okay, you need to find the disease and fight and follow. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say in the case of aquaculture. You need to find means, okay, you need to have proper monitoring to see that whether your animal is in good condition or not. Okay, find means, okay, it's applicable both for the fish as well as the pathogen. So you need to find whether the fish is good or bad. Whether the pathogen is present or not, and what kind of fight you need to have, whether the fight means, okay, preventive measures or curative measures, it's needed, and follow the practices, follow the good management practices or good aquaculture practices. Okay, so with these few words, let me thank every audience for the patient hearing, and also the host institutions to give me a chance to share my thoughts to all the fellow science persons. Okay, so let me stop with this. If you have any doubt, you can have that discussion. So you can have the discussion for.
Thank you, sir. Okay. There are few questions in the chat itself.
Okay.
You can click on the chat. There is chat, the green icon. Yes, exactly. Okay. Please click on it. You can scroll up. You can scroll up to see questions. There are few questions at the start.
Okay. Yeah, you can. Let me go one by one.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Now, okay, extempore also you can try. Yeah, before I read, okay. So
yes. Okay. If there are any questions, you can directly ask.
Yes, I was going fast, okay, because the time, since time, many slides were there.
Then, thank, okay, you, possibly. Thank you for being considerate enough to finish it in time. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So thumb rule, sir. Yes, thumb rule before identification of the disease pathogen, which may be sometime true. Okay, what treatment can be done in a pond? Okay. Of course, this is Sushant Karki. Okay, Sushant, I may not be advising you to go for treatment. Okay, so as a conscious person, I will not be advising you to go for treatment. Okay, so you need to have some kind of, okay, preventive measures to see that the pathogens are not entering in your system. Okay, the treatment is the last resort. Okay, treatment is the last resort. Okay, so that can be done. Okay, so again, if you wanted to go for treatment, you need to identify what exactly the causative agent. If you find that, okay, it is due to, and okay, if it is due to pathogenic, if it is due to the pathogen, and the pathogen may be a virus, then no treatment is possible. Okay, do not go for antibiotic addition. Okay, if virus is identified as a causative agent, do not go for antibiotic. There is no viral agent available for shrimp or fish. Okay, so this is case. So in that case, no treatment is possible. And if it is for, if you are identifying it as a causative agent as a bacteria, say for the Aeromonas hydrophila, you can go for oxytetracycline. Only two antibiotics are permissible, okay, and one more antibiotic is also conditionally approved. One is oxytetracycline can be used. It can be used at the rate of 50 mg per kg body weight per day for 10 days. Okay, 50 to 80 mg that can be used. Another one is potentiated sulfonamide that can be used at a concentration of 50 mg per day for 7 days. And the third one is fluorphenicol. This is conditionally approved. The fluorphenicol is commercially, it is not available now in India. Okay, so we Indian conditions, we are left with only two antibiotics for bacterial treatment. and no other chemicals have been approved for use in aquaculture in Indian condition. Not even any chemicals. Okay, no chemicals are except the formalin can be used for anti-parasite. Okay, and that too under strict conditions. Okay, this is one. Possibly it is clear if I am correct. Susan?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, right. Okay, now I would advise everyone not to go for any treatments. You can think about preventive measures. Okay, how can we stop spreading episodic ulcerative in India? Okay, how can we stop? Okay, so possibly spread of it is it's a $1 million question. We cannot stop EES spread because it comes with the nature. It comes with the nature, especially when that rainwater comes, especially immediately after the monsoon. Okay, immediately after the monsoon, through the organic waste, it goes and it spreads. Okay, so you cannot have any control over it. But so it can be prevented by use of liming. Okay, if any farm have got some kind of large amount of organic matter, you can go for decomposing the organic matter using the lime. Okay, so that can be help you to spread. Help to prevent the spread of EES if the spores are available. Okay. So that's the only thing you can do that, okay? Because if you can reduce the organic matter to a greater extent by using lime or some other organic decomposers, that can be helpful there, okay? But very difficult to prevent the spread of EES because it is mostly affecting the wild population. Wild population, especially the larger water bodies, okay, you cannot go for a large amount of chemical application in a particular system. Even if you can go for lime addition, tons and tons of lime is required. Okay, so that is not always applicable for commercial application. Okay, then another one is Satyanarayana Saravana. Okay, how can you monitor the diagnosis seed stock material? Okay, seed stock material. Stock material, of course, many such laboratories are available. You can try. Okay. Of course, monitor. Okay, so monitoring and diagnosis. Okay, so say for example, this depending upon the quality, okay, the nature of the fish species which you have selected. Okay, so and the nature of pathogen which you are targeting. Where the diagnosis, that, as I said, okay, more than 1,000 diseases have been reported. Okay, all 1,000 diseases cannot be diagnosed. Okay, what you are intended? You need to identify the risk for the particular species. Then you can go for the diagnosis. Say for example, Venami. Venami, the most problem is due to WSV. So your diagnosis is targeted only towards WSV. No other pathogens are needed. Okay, and the certification is also on the basis of this one. And the sensor-based diagnostic methods followed in commercially. Sensor-based, of course, still it is not commercially available. Commercially, it is not available, but it is it is in the offing. Okay, some cases with the sensor-based diagnostic method. Possibly, I am not correct. It is available commercially. Okay, it is experimental stage. It is available. Third question is eco-friendly technology available for the farmer. What are all the eco-friendly technology? Okay, many of the herbal products, many of the herbal products which are eco-friendly that can be tried. Okay, another thing is that optimal eco-friendly means optimal water quality maintenance. Okay, optimal environmental condition that you can do. Okay, so eco-friendly technology. So herbal products, that is one of the important thing which you can think about. Okay, what are the nanoparticle used in fish disease rather than the gold nanoparticle. I am not a man of a nanotechnology. Okay, so gold particle. Okay, so possibly I can. I would request you to search there Google. Many such technologies are available, but commercially none of the nanoparticles have been recommended for aquaculture operation. If I am correct, am I correct? Subramaniam Saravana.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So commercially no such nanoparticles have been permitted for aquaculture use. Okay. Everything is in experimental stage. Okay. Unless otherwise, environmental toxicity is assessed. Okay. It is very difficult to get that approval. Okay. So only after approval only you can do that. Commercially nothing is available. Okay. So everything is on trial and error. Basis only then, okay, on laboratory scale only it is available. Okay, so we have a long way to go regarding the nanotechnology on its application, but many such good positive results are coming, but many are still in the infant stage. Okay, then another one is, can you please explain briefly about the bacteriophage treatment? Okay, bacteriophage treatment identify. Okay, so bacteriophage treatment is specific to specific pathogen. So first you need to identify that what is the exact pathogen for a particular species. I have given an example of luminous vibriosis. Luminous vibriosis is caused by Vibrio Harvey. Okay, Vibrio Harvey. So you need to identify bacteriophages, because you know that bacteriophages are specific. They are specific pathogen. Okay, so a specific microorganism. Okay, so that must be identified, whether it is present or available, and whether it is able to kill that bacteriophage, bacterial pathogen. If it is proved and certified that it is safe, the bacteriophage is safe, then only you can think about bacteriophage treatment is safe or not. Okay, again, I will not be recommending any such new technology immediately, because everything has to undergo the policy clearance. Okay, policy clearance. Okay, you need to prove that, okay, that the technology what you have developed is safe for treatment, a human being as well as the environment. Okay, so environment clearance, okay, the policy clearance and the guidelines to be made. Okay, a package of technology to be developed, only when it can be commercialized. Okay, so say for example, somewhere I read, okay, so this Vibrio Harvey in some of the foreign countries, so they have commercialized, but it still hangs in balance regarding the clearance in many of their regulatory authorities. Okay, is it clear, Saravana?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so if there is treatment available, biocontrol agent to treat fish disease apart from the chemo treatment. Okay, so biocontrol. Okay, here again, because many such technologies are available, biocontrol. Say for example, it starts with shrimp. In the case of shrimp, so normally they use molasses. They use molasses to augment the production of one particular group of organism. Molasses is a glucose material. It's a starch material. Okay, so that favors a particular group of vibrios. Okay, particular group of vibrios, which utilizes starch material, especially the sucrose. Okay, the sucrose, especially the Vibrio paragammaleticus, Vibrio alginoliticus and other group of organisms which can utilize this one. So it started from there then. Many of the countries, they use molasses as a biocontrol agent, okay, to stimulate it. Stimulates biostimulant, so that produces large amount of Vibrio alginoliticus, which are having antimicrobial activity against the luminous vibriosis caused by Vibrio Harvey or Vibrio paragammaleticus. This started with that. Subsequently, many such compounds are available. Many such pure cultures have been proposed, mainly from the algae, dinoflagellates, and many of the microorganisms having antibacterial activity, but commercially none are proved successful on a commercial application. Laboratory scale, it has been proposed, okay, but commercially nothing is available because of its status. Because anytime it may occur some of the genes from the natural environment when it is available in larger numbers, because in natural environment the possibility of the gene transfer from one organism to another, okay, through the natural process, it is more. When large number of microorganisms are available under that category, okay, the regulations are still problematic. Okay, so this, under these conditions, okay, the biocontrol, it is one of the viable thing, okay, but it depends on the approval, because many of these recent technologies have not been approved yet. Okay, so which are the areas, many such things are depending upon the environment. Okay, so how nanotechnology helps in the diagnosis of the diseases. So this is by Anjali Ravani. Okay, so I am not a man of nanotechnology.
No, you have mentioned.
No, I have mentioned. Okay, I am 100% sure that I have mentioned that this is the nanotechnology. But I mean, how it is useful in the diagnosis of the disease, I do not know that. Let me give the information after getting the details from the system. So right now I am not able to get. Okay, you can ask, if you get any information, you can pass on the information. I will be happy to have the details from that.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Sorry to help you in this regard, but I will try to get the information.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Then, iodine is suitable for treating bacterial diseases. Okay. Iodine is not a suitable treatment, but it is a preventive measure. Okay. It is not treatment, it's a preventive measure. Okay. The water can be treated. Okay. Or the instruments which are used in the shrimp farming can be better treated through the bacteria, or even it can be used as a hand wash. Okay, especially the povidone iodine is one of the drug. Okay, it is one of the possibly I can say the low regulatory priority drug. Okay, low priority regulatory drug as per US FDA. So that can be used iodine for use in water treatment, not for the treatment of the diseases. Okay, so it can be used for the water treatment. It is one of the technology proposed by US FDA. It's one of the approved drug. Okay. What is the status of seed certification in CARP? Okay, of course, seed certification. Okay, the government of India has been insisting that state government has to have a mechanism to certify the seeds. Okay, it is being implemented, but it is not organized in a scientific manner. So they visit every hatchery, and the hatcheries are accredited. Okay, it is not certified. It is not every hatcheries are accredited. Okay. So the state government is empowered to accredit the hatchery with the condition that, okay, it is under the purview of government of respective state department. Okay, but if you can see that accreditation, okay, so you need to see certain many such guidelines are available. Every 2 years you need to change the brood stock. Okay, so that whether they are the farmers, whether the brooders are following the same tricks or not, okay, that is a $1 million question. Okay, but this seed certification is not possible in the case of one, because we do not have many such primary pathogen in the case of CARP. Okay, but accreditation is viable option. Okay, it is being done. And fin fishes in India, okay, it is not possible in the case of certification. But shrimp, it is possible, because we need to have a specific pathogen status. Okay, and which are the responsible organization? It is nothing but the respective state government. Okay, it is the respective state government or the responsible organization for certification. Okay, and private organizations are there. Say for example, and if you are thinking about the export of seeds, okay, you need to get the certification from the MPEDA. Okay, say for example, if you wanted to export the shrimp, okay, ornamental fish or ornamental seeds, okay, you need to get the certificate from the MPEDA. They are the only certifying organization for certification. Okay, so no other organization, even that ICAR institutions are not empowered. They can give you the report. Okay, they can give the report, but that is not a certificate. Okay, no other organization is empowered other than MPEDA. Okay, then okay, shall we use CIFAX to reduce EES? It can be used. Okay, so actually CIFAX is developed for containing the EES only. Then okay, this is one of the important findings of the CIFA. And commercialized, okay, still it is application in many of the countries, many of the states. Okay, then my presentation, I have a question. And why not commercial based rare group of probiotics? Dr. Prakash, okay, I have one question. Why not commercial based rare group of probiotics? What specific reason? What do you mean, sir?
Sorry for the typographic error. Why not commercial based rare acnobacteria, like that of acnobacteria and fungus, in probiotic in commercial application, available. Yeah. So any specific reasons are there?
No, still I am not able to get you. Okay, so what echo is coming?
Okay. Why not commercial based rare acnobacteria, like that of acnobacteria and fungal group of probiotic in commercial available? My question.
Okay, so why it is not available? Okay.
So, sir,
there is a criteria to say that, okay, the product, that microorganism is an ideal probiotic. If it fulfills, it can be used. Possibly the acinetobacter, actinomyces or fungal species, what you mean, they may not be fulfill the ideal criteria for the, sir, the criteria for an ideal probiotic. If it fulfills, any organism can be used. Okay, so it is not fulfilling that ideal criteria, so that's what it is not included. Another thing is that, okay, you said fungus may not come in the under the probiotic group. Maybe they are a very good decomposers. Possibly that can be used as an organic matter decomposers. Organic matter decomposes. Another organism, is it actinomyces or actinobacter?
Sorry, this is a special group of bacteria, actinomycetes.
Actinomycetes.
Gram positive bacteria.
Yes, yes.
Actinomycetes. I have working in an acnobacterial group.
Okay.
That is the reason I was asking the question. My doubt.
So, okay, many of the actinomyces are potential source of antibiotics. Okay. Many of the actinomyces are potential source of antibiotics, and many of the antibiotics are not going well with the biological system of fish. Say, for example, oxytetracycline. Oxytetracycline is produced by one group of actinomyces, streptomyces. Am I correct, sir?
Yeah, sir.
Okay. Oxytetracycline, though it is an approved antibiotic, okay, when it goes beyond certain level, it is going to have some kind of adverse effect on the liver and the kidney and some other organ, even the cells. Okay. So that is the reason why many of the actinomyces, by virtue of its ability to produce many kind of antibiotic, maybe natural product, but when it levels goes beyond certain level, okay, when it is produced in larger numbers, when it is applied in biological system, when it goes in larger numbers and produces large quantities of this chemical compound, that is going to have an effect on the product. Another thing is that antibiotic, okay, so many of the antibiotics should not be present in the food fishes when it is taken for consumption. Okay, so as per the government condition that, okay, so the antibiotic should not be present even in traces. That's a zero tolerance.
Yeah, okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. Zero tolerance. So that's the reason why, okay, such kind of products, okay, so are not commonly used, because it has to fulfill the ideal probiotic criteria. So then only it can be used. So many of the biological agents cannot be used. So most of the ideal probiotics are, say, for example, the lactic acid bacteria. Okay, it is commercially, it is considered as an ideal group. Another one is, okay, water probiotic, nitrobacter. Okay, so these are some of the two major groups considered as, okay, gut probiotic as well as water probiotic. Okay, so these are the things. Okay, then any other questions?
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Then okay, so then from Selvaraj, TNJFU, sir, are there any advantage of bioflux based nitrate system over the conventional system in terms of disease resistance? Yes, gentlemen. Okay, it is advantage. Any biological system we use, it is going to have very good. Somebody can close the okay. Okay, so that any biological system have to have very good advantage on the fish immune system. Okay, the bioflux is one such system. So it is going to have very good system over the conventional system. Okay, especially in the case of developing disease resistance. Okay, but again, you need to see that. Okay, so whether it is bioflux, it's also leading to some other complications in terms of diseases. Especially the lymphocystis problems are very often happening in the case of bioflux system, especially in the case of coica. Okay, so always any biological system in aquaculture, introduction of biological system aquaculture is always welcome. Okay, so compared to conventional system. Okay. Then anything else? Okay, how can we prevent? Okay, this from Saku, occurrence of argillus, particularly in ponds that cannot be dried. Okay. So possibly, and I would request, okay, next class, possibly Dr. Gadadhar, okay, will be giving. So you can put forth your question there for argillus. Okay. So many of the farmers use argillus still, okay, liters and liters of pesticides. Okay, pesticides. And Gadadhar sir may be giving a very good experience. He has a very good experience on that. Many such commercial products are available on argillus control. Okay, herbal-based products are available. Okay, only thing is that, okay, so you need to reduce that organic load. Argillus is quite common when that organic load goes high. Okay, organic level is high, the argillus problem comes. Okay, if you can maintain that organic level to a minimum level, okay, so that is the best way of preventing that argillus control. Okay, so details, possibly you will get more, you will be more enlightened on these questions from next class from my colleague, Dr. Gadadhar. Okay, so he is an expert in parasitology who can help you in this particular regard. Possibly no other questions in this regard. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sago. Any other things? Any other question? So if no questions are there, okay, let me thank everyone for your patient hearing. Okay, almost I was going like a bullet. Okay, so if anybody wants the presentation, I can share the presentation in PPT form. Okay, PPT form, sir, not in PPT form, PDF form. Okay, PPT is too high. Many images are available, and you can send my, of course, my numbers are available, email is available, you can send a mail. Okay, so I can share the task. Okay, it is not monopoly. Okay, so I can share if anybody is interested, that material can be shared. Okay. Okay, so thank you very much, friends.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.